let us today learn about network layer. Okay, so let us start with the introduction to network layer. Okay, let us see about the introduction to network layer. So as you know, we have 7 layers, that is physical layer, data link layer, network layer, transport layer and application layer. So we are discussing about the network layer, right? So network layer is a layer which falls just below the transport layer, whereas it falls above the data link layer. So network layer receives the service from data link layer, whereas it provides the service to transport layer. So here network layer main functionality is it is responsible for routing. So routing takes place based on in the IP addressing. Okay, so how does routing takes place and all, we'll see with one example. So you can see a diagram here. You can see one diagram here. In this one, there is one user Alice. He wants to send the data to the Bob. Okay, so the data from Alice, it reaches, flows through many of the network devices and finally it reaches the Bob. So in this one, as you can see, Alice is connected with one computer. Initially he sends the data to one of its nearby router, right? So this router, you can think of internet service provider who has provided this router. This internet service provider is in turn connected to the external world. Okay, you can call it as national internet service provider. Okay, and through this one you can observe switched WAN, that is wide area network, lots of devices, routers, gateways are crossed over, and finally the data reaches to the internet service provider router of the destination. From that router, finally it is delivered to the device of the Bob. Okay, from this switch, the Bob is connected at this point and data is delivered. Okay, so parallelly a diagram is shown here, right? From Alice, it is a computer, therefore it has 7 layers. We are discussing only about the network layer. So data is captured from the top layer and it is starts moving. So initially data is sent to data layer, data link layer, then it is passed to physical layer. From this, it reaches this router. So in this router, initially it is picked up at physical layer, then it moves to data link layer, and we add the routing configuration. That is, this is one network and this another network. IP address at this point and this point will be different. Okay. Therefore, this routing configuration is done. Then finally, again the data is forwarded. Again, it moves to data link layer, physical layer. And again it goes on and reaches to another router R4, that is here. Okay, then it is next passed on to the another router R5, that is this router, and from this R5 it reaches to R7. Okay, so again data reaches to R7, then from R7 it finally reaches to the Bob. Finally it comes and reaches the Bob. So now Bob is a 7 layer device. In this 7 layer, data is picked from physical layer, data link layer, network layer. This network layer delivers the data finally to the transport layer, and then it delivers to the application layer. So you can see here the routers, it has 3 layers. Every router has 3 layers, right? And it is, you can see there is a split up of data and physical layer into 2. Why? Because the one end is this indicates it is connected to one network. And these two splits indicate that it is again connected to another network. So router connects two different networks. So one IP address to this one, another IP address to this one. Similarly, one IP address to this one, another IP address to this one. So every router connects a multiple network. Therefore we require 2 IP addresses here for router. So router may have multiple IP address. So through this path, data is finally goes and reaches Bob. So this is just an example how a network layer works. Now let us see what are all the functionalities of the network layer. So along with routing, The initial responsibility of router is to create packets. So that is packetization. So what are the packets then? Payload or data from transport layer is taken, and for that source and destination IP address and other informations are added, and we call it as a packet. Then further packet is pushed down to data link layer. Okay, such many packets are again will be added with header of the data link layer. We call it as a frame. So data from transport layer is taken, we add the headers, then finally the packet is created. So that is simply the packet, right? So now when we come for a routing we have already discussed here. So routing is the one data is taken from one system and it is delivered to the any other part of a net, any other different network. So it is not like a data link layer where it delivers data, like in case of data link layer it delivers data from hop to hop, whereas routing will be delivering the data, that is a network layer delivers the data from one computer and to another computer, where both the computers can be in a different networks. So over the network data will be delivered by routing tables, this by network layer. Once this routing is done, next functionality is forwarding. So what does this forwarding means? When we do the routing, initially we create a routing table. So that routing table will be updated. Based on that routing table, data will be forwarded. So we call it as a unicast routing, and this is one of the functionality of the network layer. So forwarding just means from source IP address to destination IP address, data will be forward. So how it is done, you can see here. So we take one value, say B, this value should need to be forwarded. So for this B we have attached a data, and that data needs to be forwarded by this router. So it is incoming is port number 1, this data should be delivered to output, that is to router at this link, it is 2. So it checks, this is a routing table. In this routing table you can see output link is 2. Just we need to forward this data to link 2. From this data it is forwarded to link 2. You can see that data is being delivered at the 2. This is simple example of a forwarding. Okay, other than these two functions, network layer, we expect the network layer to do some other functionalities. That is, we want it to do error controlling. Okay, what do you mean by error controlling? Then error control is the one in which we add some checksums at the end. If any error has occurred while delivering the data, they have to be detected and corrected. That is error control, prevent the errors. But in this case, network layer, so we can check that error control is done at only header. So we will not add the data to payload, but not into whole datagram. We will take a header, then we'll apply error correction only to header, not to the complete payload. That you can think of. Then next one, so usually the error control in this one is done at header only. We apply a checksum for header, and that is also taken care by this ICMP protocol, not at the network layer. It is done at parallelly at a different protocol, that is ICMP. So by default network will not be responsible for again error control. And we want the network layer to do the flow control also, right? But this is also not done, because flow control, you can think the flow control is one of the biggest responsibility of the transport layer. So transport layer will take care of flow control, therefore no need of a extra burden to this network layer. So why we are not adding a flow control concept in network layer? So one thing is, it will, as already upper layer provides a flow control, so no need to add extra overburden to this one. Okay, so upper layers use the functionality of this network layer and they do the flow control over the upper layer, that is transport layer is responsible. So no need to add the another thing, if already error control is being done at data link layer, again at the transport layer, so no need to add the extra again burden overhead in this network layer. Therefore, this flow control is not done at this level, right? So next we go for congestion control. So what do you mean by congestion? Means within a single link there may be huge number of data or the packets present that is over the capacity of that transportation level. So in that case we have already discussed about the congestion. So if congestion occurs, then what happens? Then no data will be delivered successfully. All the data will get collided and they drop out. So routers are somewhat responsible to prevent this, the congestion control. That means there should not be overcrowded packets in the same link. So that's why what routers will do, routers will decide many different paths through which data can be delivered freely. So they will not keep on routing in only one path. Therefore, they have the flexibility to route the packets in multiple routes. Therefore, there will not be any congestion. So the routers can control the congestion. Then quality of service. So based on the multimedia applications, like video, audio applications, email application, text applications, the quality of service depends. So each service require different parameters, right? Quality of service. So quality of service is again not controlled by this routing or network layer. It is taken care by higher layers like application, presentation and transport layers. Again, when we come for security, initially the security in this routing layer was not designed, not set up. But if we really want to go for security, because it's a big concern now, security issue. Therefore, in router there are two concepts are there. One is connection less and connection oriented. So if you go for connection oriented, then security is there. If you go for connection less, security will not be there. So network layer provides connection security with the connection oriented services. So another functionality of this network layer is packet switching, right? So what does it means by packet switching is one of the method to route the packet. Okay, here I am showing a diagram in which many switches are connected. If you want to deliver the data from this point to this point, okay, then so it can go through either this path, or it can go with either this path, or it can go with either this path. There are multiple paths are there, right? Then how does switching will takes place? Okay, so here the switching is, that means what, I can physically connect this, I can connect physically these links together and make a connection, that becomes a circuit switched. That means what we'll do is here I will try to show you. If you want to connect to this system, what I will do, then I will close these links initially. So from this I take one request. So if a dialing is from this system to this system, what I will do, physically I will connect like this. So switches will link together and make a connection to this PC and establish a connection. That is a circuit switching network. So in packet switching network, what happens, already connections are there, physical connections are there. Logically we link this to this system. I will enable this path, so that they get connected. Physically already they are connected. Logically we create a path from here to here, they get enabled, so that they start communicating. So this is one of the method of packet switching, right? So there are two methods are there in this one. One is just send the data packets, we don't decide any route. So in that case what happens, data may be delivered from here to here. One packet may go with this path, another packet may go with this path, another packet may follow a random path like this and reach the destination. But when I create a virtual connection and send the data, then initially we create a setup a link like this virtually, then over that links we send the data. There are two methods, we'll discuss them one by one. So as we can see, switching is just nothing but connecting two different links together, okay? So that switching means connecting the network's route to creating a link of a path, that is called as switching. So in this switching there are two types, that is one is packet switching and circuit switching. In case of circuit switching, you physically connect the two links together to make a connection, like especially in the BSNL office and all, it will be a physical connection that will be doing. But when we go for a packet switching, internet completely follows based on packet switching. The connections are already available, we just configure them and send the data. No need of creating a physical connection. So virtually the connection is created and sent. So in that also there are two types, one is datagram approach and virtual circuit approach. Okay, so the one of the method is discussed here. Okay, we can see here, this is the approach of a connectionless packet switched network. So it is a connectionless, we are not creating any connection. Okay, in this one you can check out, that is we want to send a data from sender, finally it should be reached by the receiver. Okay, so sender wants to send 4 packets, so they are sent in a serial order, like 1 2 3 4, right? But here how the data is delivered. Assume there is a network, like we have router 1, router 2, router 3, router 5, router 4. There are many routers, they are all connected together like this, right? We have a connection, right? And finally data should reach the destination. Okay, router destination is connected to router 5. So in this case you can think that data 1, packet 1 comes. Okay, packet 1 reaches router 1, then it is sent to router 4, then it reaches to 5, then it is delivered. Then router 2 will come later, router 2 follows this path and it is delivered. Router 3, that is packet 3, takes this path, then it is delivered. Packet 4 takes this path, then it is delivered. But as it is coming over different paths over here, finally what happens, they are in out of order, right? They should be 1, 2, 3, 4, they are coming out of order. So in this case, there will be a problem for rearranging. Therefore, what they keep? They keep the legends. 1, 2, 3, 4, they create a sequence numbers. Even though they are coming out of order, initially this network, the transport layer is responsible for that rearrangement. So it takes the packets and rearranges them and it will be delivered back. Okay. So this happens in a connectionless datagram. So packets will come, they may follow any path and finally they come out in an out of order fashion. So we have another method that is called as virtual circuit approach and connection oriented service. Okay, so in this what happens, you can check the diagram here. So again here we want to send the data from sender to receiver, the same routers are there, right? So what we are doing, we are creating a connection. Connection is created. So what is that connection? So if we select a path, this path is selected to deliver, that is over router 1, router 3, router 4 and finally to the destination. So what we do, initially we establish a connection. So how the connection is established? You can think of, initially there is already a physical connection is there. Okay, but what we do, virtually we configure, from this data should reach to router 1, from this router data should go to router 3, from this it should go to router 4, finally it should reach the registration. We configure these routers together with the routing table approach. Then after configuration we start sending the data. In this one what happens, you can clearly observe that 1 2 3 4, initially it comes to router 1, then they are delivered to router 3, and they are delivered to router 4 and router 5 in a serial order. There is no out of order. So you can take this virtual blue color virtual circuit is created and packets are coming in order. This is a connection oriented approach. Okay, this is another method. So this connection oriented method has three methods, sub methods, that is initially we have to set up phase, then data transfer phase and tear down, that is closing phase. We'll discuss them one by one. Okay, so in setup phase what happens? So in setup phase, initially we send a request packet. Okay, so once the request package is reached by the destination, from source to destination it is sent. So while going, it creates a path. While getting back the actual element, it completes the establishment of the path. So initially this connection, that path is created. So that path creation is called as setup phase. Okay, we'll see what is there, what will be there in setup phase. So what we do, we send a request packet. Okay, so how that request packet is sent? Initially you can see here, from source request packet is sent. That is one step, steps are shown here, 1, then 2, then 3, then 4. Okay, steps are shown. So what we do, we need to create a virtual path. Okay, in this one we can see here, right? So this router 1 has a routing table, this one, this is a routing table of router. Then this is a routing table of this router 3, this is a routing table of R4, right? So whenever a packet from A comes to router 1, it makes an entry. So 3 entries are made. So what the entries are made, you can check incoming. So in incoming, what is the port number of this router? Incoming port number is 1. Okay, and so incoming port number is 1. The packet which is coming in, it has a label 14, right? Then that means this router will be receiving many packets. Other than this link, there may be many packets which will be coming with different labels. But from this port, right? Okay, from this port, if a packet comes with a label 14, that is taken, right? Then outgoing packet from this router, outgoing port from this router will be 3, right? That is 3. So you can see the entry here, it is 3, right? So what will be the outgoing packet label? It will initially, it will not be known. So when we get back the acknowledgement from B, then this entry is made. We'll see what happens one by one. Then from this router, packet is forwarded to router 3. So in router 3, what happens? For router 3, incoming port number is 3. What is the label of this one? So label will be again assigned by this router 3. So port number is 1. So what label initially is assigned? 66. Okay, how it is, which outgoing path it should select? That is port number 3, that is selected. So what will be the label of outgoing packet? That is not given, that will be assigned later. From this it reaches the router 4. In router 4, what is the port number incoming? It is again 1. Okay, 1. And what is the label while incoming? It is again set by this router 4, that is 22. So what link it should go out? That is port 4. So what label it will be assigned right now? Okay, so when a packet is coming in, initially it is assigned with which port number it is coming and what label it is coming. Every time, which port number it is coming and what label it is coming and through which port it is going out, three values are entered, right? So once this request from source to destination B, it is reached. So initially this path is requested now. So B will give an acknowledgement to confirm this path. So B will assign the outgoing packets label. That is, from, you can check here through this router port. So outgoing was 4, and this 4 B will be assigning, what will be its label? So now 77 is the label assigned. Okay, so again when this confirmation is will come, again this router 4 will assign a label for outgoing packet from router 3. That is, now router 4 will assign 22 as outgoing packet label for router 3. Now this 22 is assigned as a outgoing packet for this router 3, right? Then again this router will assign a outgoing packet for this router. That is 66 is assigned by this router 3 as a outgoing packet. Again this router will assign already the incoming packet. There is no outgoing packet, already it is assigned. So once acknowledgement that these labels are assigned back, finally the link is completely set up now. Request and get back the acknowledgement is set up. So after this one, data transmission starts. Okay, now it is called as a data transmission phase. Okay, data transmission phase. So in this one, what happens? Now data from A. So we take the data from this trip A. We know the label for it, 14. So that along with source IP address and destination IP address. Source is A, destination is B. So for every packet along with the data, we add source IP address, destination IP address and data. They are all forwarded. Along with this one, extra one information, that is label is added here. Label is 14. Okay. So this 14 label, until it reaches router 1, it will be there. Again afterwards label is changed. So with 14 is the incoming label, it comes to router 1. Initially it comes to router 1. Then now this router will send the data to router 3 with a label of 66. Then this router will send the data to router 4 with a label of 22. Then this one will send the data to B with a label of 77. Okay, finally data reaches to B. So what you can observe here is the path selection is, once it depends upon the port number and also it depends upon the packet label which is coming. Why the necessity of this packet label is there? In real time, there will not be only one packet coming to this router. There may be huge number of packets coming to this router. That is, along with this same link, along with this link, see, only the data from this A to B will not be coming. Data from some other system may come with this path, other system may come with this path. So at a time, we'll be having multiple packets in the same link. To separate those links, we require these labels. So with the labels only, we can identify the path, or else it will be very difficult. So by this, data is delivered. Once the data is delivered, next phase will be tear down phase. So in tear down phase, what happens? Once A sends the data complete, all the packets are sent, it's allow at the end, it sends a tear down packet. It asks B to disable the connection. Once all the packets are reached by B, B starts a confirmation that delete that link. So finally that link will be deleted. So this is a connection oriented routing phase. Okay. So then for what is the actual working of this network layer discussed here. So what physical layer does? So physical layer is just converting the data into physical medium, that is binary ones and zeros into like electrical signals or optical signals, they are connected. Then what about the data link layer? So data link layer is responsible for integrity of the data, that is error correction, controlling without loss the data should be delivered. That is the responsibility of data link layer. Then what is the responsibility of network layer? So network layer is responsible for creating the route and sending the data from one source to destination. We are using different physical links. Finally, data will be delivered to the transport layer. Then from that one, it delivers data to higher layers. Okay. So network layer routes the packets using a IP address. That IP address is called as logical address. So in real world, we create various LANs and WANs together, and they are all connected together by IP address. Okay, so globally the IP address cannot be same. So each system will have different IP address. So in case what happens, if we assign one IP address for one system, if no more that system is not using that IP address, then that IP address will be deleted and it will be assigned to some other system. Okay. So the physical address we have discussed already, that is comes in a data link layer. We also call it as a MAC address or network interface card, NIC address. So that is a physical address which is assigned at data link layer. So here we'll be calling it as logical address or IP address. Okay. And one more thing, a system cannot have multiple address. This IP address is also called as logical address, or it is also called as network address. We actually call this IP address as a network address, right? So IP address can be assigned to one of a router. If we take a router will have many IP addresses. Each IP address will have its own link, right? Let me show you. Okay, this is a best example you can think of, that is there is, you can think of this one as one of the LAN, and you can think of it as a EC department. For in essence, there are many systems which are connected to one switch. You can think of a ICT department, another department, and for this department many devices are connected using this switch. Again, you can think of CS department, many switches are there. One switch is there, many systems are connected to this switch, right? And finally, this switch from the CNC department connects to router, switch from ICT department connects to router, switch from the CSE department connect to this router. So you can think of the IP addresses here clearly. It is 192.168.3.1. This refers to this network, and this IP address, that is 192.168.1.1, this IP address refers to this network, right? And 192.168.2.1, this IP address refers to the third network. So each network has IP address. So router can have so many IP addresses. How many links are there, that many IP addresses will be there for router, right? And even each system has its own IP address, right? Each system has its own IP address, right? This is one of the best example. Now this router can have IP address can be of two types, and is IPv4 addressing, IPv6 addressing. IPv4 is 32 bit addressing, whereas IPv6 is 128 bit addressing. You have only IPv4 addressings right now, therefore we'll discuss only about this IPv4 addressing. Okay, so IP address will be of 32 bit IP address, we'll see it later. And IP address will define connection of a device to internet. Whenever we want to connect to internet, we must have one IP address, and no other systems in any world can have a same IP address. Okay, so we call it as one more term called is address space. That is how many devices can be connected in using one IP address. If the number of, that directly depends upon a number of bits. Here IPv4 has number of bits as 32 bits, therefore 2 to the power of 32 will give you around more than this 4 billion. 4 billion devices are possible using IP address. But if you go for IPv6, that will be 2 to the power of 128. You can just imagine how many folds it will be increased, number of devices in a network. So this address space gives how many systems or how many network devices we can be possible in an IP address, right? Okay, so now IP address can be represented either in binary donation notation or dotted decimal notation. We'll see them one by one. So if we have a 32 bit address, then we divide it into 4, that is 8 bit, 8 bit, 8 bit, 8 bit, 8 into 4, 32, right? So each 8 bit is represented. So in the represented in the final form of zeros and ones, that is binary representation. If we go for a dotted decimal representation, then we have a decimal number. So each 8 bit is converted into decimal number, and it is separated by a dot like this. Separated by a dot. So we'll again have a 4 values. They are all decimal. They are separated by decimal dots. We call it as a dotted decimal representation. The same thing is shown here. So binary number and its decimal number. Binary number, decimal number. Binary and decimal. Binary and decimal. They are separated by dots. So we call it as a each byte as octet, 8 bits. So its range will be from 0 to 255 because it is 2 to the power of 8. That will be 256, that is 0 to 256. We have a problem here, you can check. Change the following IP address from binary notation to dotted decimal. You can easily do it. This 1 followed by 0 and 1, it is 129. Convert this binary to decimal number. So this is 1011, it is 11. Again 1011, it is 11. This will be 234. and this will be 193. So this all ones will be 255. So like this you can convert the binary number into the dotted decimal IP addressing. Okay, this is a wrong another problem. Convert this dotted decimal into binary, that is just a reverse operation. 111 will be represented by this number, 7 is represented by 000111, and like that we are converting each decimal number into its respective binary number. Here they are represented by separated by dot, here they are separated by space, that's it. So next problem is find out any error if in the following IPv4 address. Okay, check out what errors are there here. So in this IP address I find one error, that is 0 will not be added as a prefix to this number. 0 we need not add, directly we write the number, that is one error. So in this number what is the error? We have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 numbers. So we cannot have 5 numbers, we will have only 4 dotted decimal numbers. In this one what error we can find is this 301. The range is only from 0 to 255, this 301 will not fit here, it is out of range. And we cannot have binary and decimal number combined together, either it is represented in binary or in the form of decimal. Okay, so classful addressing is there, that we will be discussing in the next class. Thanks for your patience listening. Thank you. See you in the next class.